Please join me with a resounding applause as I invite the Director of Legal Services, Nigerian Army, Brig Gen YI Shalangwa, to please come forward and present his lecture.
And this staff ably represented by the Chief of Policy and Plans, Major General LJ of Norway. The Director General, Nigerian Army Resource Center, Senior Officers, ladies and gentlemen. So let me start first by apologizing to the Director General, Nigerian Army Resource Center, to the fact that my paper is, in a way, just in point form because of my commitment elsewhere. I won't be able to come up with a detailed lecture. But I believe that at the end of the day, we will still be able to get one or two things from the paper I'm going to present. Without much wasting of time, my paper is on command responsibilities, the legal perspective. By way of introduction, I want to say that the Nigerian Army Resource Center was directed by the Chief of Army Staff to organize the ongoing seminar, or the one-day seminar, on leadership and command responsibilities for officers of the rank of colonel and brigadier general of the Army, or equivalent, in the sister services, and of course, other security agencies. The Nigerian Army Resource Center, in its invitation letter to me, for this lecture, rightly observed that there has been an increase in the operational engagements of the armed forces and other security agencies within and outside the country in the recent past due to current and emerging security challenges. Although a lot of successes have been recorded in those operations, some obvious lapses have equally been observed, especially as it relates to command and leadership. To my mind and understanding, command is leadership, and leadership is command. Command is a word or phenomenon commonly associated with the military and other security agencies, while leadership, on the other hand, is a word or phenomenon more associated with civilian or democratic system. Command or leadership is a phenomenon well rooted in law, legitimacy, and morality. Command or leadership, therefore, simply defined, means authority or responsibility. Authority or responsibility is a function of the law. It is the law that establishes or creates the office of a commander or leader, empowers him with authority and spells out his responsibilities. Thank God for the lecture delivered by the GOC, YG, and giving us detailed definition of command, and of course, the fact that the commander is a leader and his attributes, which includes integrity, honesty, courage, ability to inspire, and so on. It's not in my paper, but at least that has been covered for us. The submissions made above clearly justify and summarizes the topic of my lecture, which is command responsibilities, the legal aspect. The paper will discuss in greater details the phenomenon or concept of command and its responsibilities from the standpoint of law. For the purpose of convenience and better understanding of our discussion on the concept of command responsibilities vis-a-vis the law, the Nigerian Army in particular and the armed forces of Nigeria in general will be used as focal points. The lessons to be drawn from the discussion will have to be relevant and applicable to the entire armed forces of Nigeria and all other security agencies in the country. The Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, 1999, has amended the Armed Forces Act, the Military Pensions Act, the Public Procurement Act, Finance Control and Management Act, Fiscal Responsibility Act, Legal Practitioners Act, the United Nations Charter, the Geneva Convention, the Rome Statute, Declaration of Human Rights Convention, for example, and a host of other domestic and international laws create huge and divergent command responsibilities. It should be noted that there are different levels of command. There are different levels of command hierarchy and responsibilities provided by the law. The Armed Forces Act 2004 clearly provides in Section 22 that the President and Commander-in-Chief may make regulations as to the person in whom command over the establishments and units or any member thereof is vested, and as the circumstances in which command is to be exercised. And without prejudice to the generality of the foregoing, may in such regulations as the President, CEC, provide for the duties, the functions, and the powers of command and staff of the Armed Forces of Nigeria. Well, to the best of my knowledge, those regulations are not to be made. So, but hopefully, with time, it will be made. These laws, regulations, orders, rules, instruments, conventions, treaties, compacts, memoranda, agreements, contracts, policies, and so on and so forth. These are all laws, you know, with a different nomenclature. They may be complex to interpret, understand, and apply. For these and other reasons, commanders at all levels need the services of professional lawyers as legal advisors on various issues in order to succeed. This could be in terms of administration, training, operations, and rank status. Commanders as leaders must consult and obtain legal advice in key and important issues before making decisions and not after making decisions. A commander or leader who values the services of his legal advisor is bound to be efficient, effective, and successful. Then, the aim of this paper is to discuss command responsibilities, the legal aspect, with a view to making appropriate recommendations. So, the paper will discuss the following. We'll look at what is command, what are responsibilities, what does the phrase the legal perspective mean? We'll look at the establishment of the armed forces of Nigeria. We'll look at administrative powers of command and legal responsibilities. We'll look at training powers of command and legal responsibilities. We'll also look at operational powers of command and legal responsibilities. That is the aspect that the GOC working party tried to count in detail, the operational powers of command. And we'll also look at the rank-based powers of command and legal responsibilities. We'll conclude and make recommendations. Now, what is command? This means, among others, to order formally, to have authority over or be in control of someone or something, to have at one's disposal, to deserve or be entitled to something, an order, control, charge, a military unit or a district under one's command, military, a specialization, or army, air force, etc. This is a dictionary definition. Now, for the purpose of this paper, we adopt the definition of command to mean to have authority over or be in control of someone or something. For example, the Chief of Army Staff has authority over and is in control of the Nigerian Army as an institution, and all officers and soldiers of the Nigerian Army as individuals come under his authority. The Chief of Army Staff thus legally has power of command over the Nigerian Army and this president. By his appointment, he has been given that authority legally. He is therefore a commander and has enormous and numerous responsibilities laid down on his shoulders by law. Now, what are responsibilities? Responsibilities mean the state of being responsible or of having important duties for which one is responsible. Something or someone for which one is responsible. In this context, the word responsible, usually responsible for someone or for something, means having charge or control over them or it, and being accountable for them or it. Responsible to someone, accountable to them for one's actions. Set of a job, position, etc., with many important duties, such as taking important decisions involving much responsibility. Responsible for something, being the cause of it, set of a person able to be trusted, able to answer for one's own conduct, capable of rational and socially acceptable behavior. That is what the dictionary provides us, what responsibilities actually mean. Now, for the purpose of this paper, we define responsibilities to mean the state of being responsible, having important duties for which one is responsible, taking important decisions or making important decisions, answer for one's own conduct, rational and socially acceptable behavior. These are all the qualities and attributes of command, commander or leader. Thank God the first paper has dwelt in detail on the qualities of a leader or commander. And it's just brief. Next, what does the phrase the legal perspective mean? The word legal means lawful, allowed by law, referring or relating to the law or lawyers created by law. On the other hand, a statement means the balanced or objective view of a situation in which all its elements assume their due importance. An individual way of regarding a situation, for example, one influenced by personal experience or considerations. In the context of this paper, therefore, the phrase, the legal perspective, means command and responsibilities of commanders, commanding officers, officers, soldiers, ratings, and aircraft men generally that are created by law. Lawful, allowed by the law and related to the law. In other words, we are going to look at the legal aspects of the responsibilities of a commander in the military, which of course is also applicable to other security agencies. That is what the legal perspective means. The GOC1D has worked in detail on the burden of command responsibilities. But in my own case, I'm looking at the legal aspects of responsibilities of the commander. Now, quickly, let's look at the establishment of the armed forces of Nigeria. The armed forces of Nigeria, comprising of the Nigerian Army, Nigerian Navy, and Nigerian Air Force, were historically established on different days so many years in the past. The legal instruments established them in those days have all been repealed, as we all know. As I said, the existing law establishing the armed forces of Nigeria are principally the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria 1999, as amended, of course, Section 217, we all know, and the Armed Forces Act, Cafe 20, those of the Federation of Nigeria 2004, in Section 1. The laws establishing the Armed Forces of Nigeria clearly charge them with the responsibilities of protecting and defending the territorial integrity of the country. They are also to provide aid to civil authorities by restoring law and order in the event of internal security breakdown in the country. The law has not changed. Of course, circumstances have changed in the country, like the GOC1D has told us, but the law has not actually changed. The military is only expected to provide support, aid to the civil authorities. In other words, it is the responsibility of the Nigerian police as the lead agency in internal security situations to first, go out to take care of the situation. It is only when they are not in a position to handle it that a formal request for the military will be made for the military to come and restore law and order. The law has not changed. The situation where we find ourselves operating side by side with the civil police, that is, the Nigerian Army or the armed forces fully engaged in police work, is actually not what the law envisages. The armed forces of Nigeria will also be charged with the responsibility of performing such other functions as may be required by law. So in other words, the armed forces are charged with the responsibility of defending Nigeria from external aggression. We can provide aid to the civil authority in terms of internal security problem. And the armed forces can also perform any other duty that may be required of them by law. For instance, we take part in during elections, we try to contribute our own quota to ensure a successful election. So that's just an example. So the armed forces can be, by law, can be asked to perform any other duty apart from these two mentioned. Now, the laws established the armed forces of Nigeria clearly provide for command structure empowered from top to bottom. The topmost commander for the armed forces of Nigeria is at debt by law, the president, commander-in-chief of the armed forces, Federal Republic of Nigeria, in person of Major General Muhammadu Buhari, retired. Is the commander-in-chief of the armed forces. The lowest commander in the armed forces of Nigeria has at debt by law, using the Nigerian army as an example, is the platoon commander. Similarly, in terms of the exercise of personal powers of command in the armed forces of Nigeria, the determining factor is rank. On this basis, the topmost rank in the armed forces of Nigeria as of today is four-star general. The army officer holding this rank as a date is, of course, the Chief of Defense Staff, General Gabriel Olonisakin. The lowest rank for the purpose of exercise of personal powers of command in the armed forces of Nigeria is a last corporal in the Nigerian army and equivalent in the Nigerian Navy and the Nigerian Air Force. For the exercise of personal powers of command, where the same rank is involved, that is, for instance, two different officers of the Nigerian Army, rank of colonel and equivalent in the other services. For example, it is apparent that seniority date becomes the determining factor. That's just one solution, where they are the same rank. In this situation, the first to be promoted can exercise personal powers of command over the officers promoted subsequently. By personal powers of command, I think it means based on rank in the armed forces, the superior, the person with the superior rank has authority over his subordinates. The law clearly provides enormous and huge responsibilities for all commanders in all categories at all levels in the armed forces of Nigeria. For example, in the categories of structured commanders, that is, the armed forces of Nigeria, the services, the formations, the units, and so on, the following commanders, to mention a few, have command responsibilities. They are, just an example, Mr. President and Commander-in-Chief, that's part of command for the armed forces. The CDS, the service chiefs, the GOCs, the FOCs, AOCs, commandants, corps commanders, brigade commanders, there are so many of them here, battalion commanding officers, officers commanding, even platoon commanders, these are all commanders by law, because they have responsibility. They are leaders at different levels in the armed forces. For the category of personal powers of command, which is solely based on superior rank, all officers and soldiers, seamen, airmen of the armed forces of Nigeria, holding the rank of the four-star general down to last corporal, also have enormous and huge command leadership responsibilities in terms of superior and subordinate relationship expectations. This paper will subsequently discuss the nature and different types of command responsibilities in the armed forces of Nigeria. Now, let's look at administrative powers of command and the legal responsibilities. Abstract definition of keywords. The first type or nature of command can be described with the adjective administrative. The noun administration means the organization and running of a system. The armed forces is a system. The three services of the armed forces of Nigeria, made up of the Army, Navy, Air Force, as a matter of law and fact, are federal government agencies. They are organizations charged with the defense of the country. For the armed forces of Nigeria to discharge this function properly, efficiently, and effectively, administration is fundamental. The armed forces of Nigeria is a complex system. Commanders or leaders at various levels run the system. It's not the chief of army staff that runs the army alone. No. Even a platoon commander, like I mentioned earlier, is a commander. He's a leader. He has responsibility at that level. Commissioned officers are mainly the commanders, leaders at various levels of the Armed Forces of Nigeria. Non-commissioned officers also have leadership role at the lower level, like I mentioned. Administration of the Armed Forces of Nigeria entails so many responsibilities. In this discussion, we shall consider only some major responsibilities in the administration of the Armed Forces of Nigeria using the Nigerian Army as an example. Now, general administration of the Armed Forces of Nigeria. The federal government of Nigeria, led by Mr. President, Commander-in-Chief, by law, established, maintains, and administers the Armed Forces of Nigeria. So he has responsibility to provide what the Armed Forces require to function. Mr. President, Commander-in-Chief, has a legal duty to ensure the administration of the Armed Forces of Nigeria to enable it effectively discharge its function of defending Nigeria by land, sea, and air, and carry out such other duties as may be prescribed by law. In this regard, Mr. President's CNC must ensure and support the Armed Forces of Nigeria to have sufficient and required establishments, formations, units, departments, corps, directors, ships, aircraft, equipment, arms, ammunition, barracks, uniforms, funding, training, officers, non-commissioned officers, soldiers, recruits, and aircraft men, among others. What I'm trying to say is that the Commander-in-Chief has to ensure that the armed forces of which he is the Commander-in-Chief have all they require to function very well. Is it the number of personnel? Is it the equipment? Kitting? Whatever. Because he is the topmost commander, like I said, and this is his own responsibility, and it is the command responsibility, administrative in nature. The truth is that the government at any point in time, headed by Mr. President CNC, deserves the kind of military force he has. Because he is the one who provides the forces. I put all the requirements. So, the federal government gets the kind of armed forces they want. Next, commissioning enlistment of officers, soldiers, regiments, and aircraft men. Commissioning of officers and enlistment of other ranks into the armed forces of Nigeria is a major administrative function. The chief of administration and military secretary and all those involved in the exercise have a sacred responsibility to ensure that the best materials, that the best persons, are brought into the system to enable the Armed Forces of Nigeria discharge its functions effectively. So when we talk about command responsibility, we are not really talking of the responsibility of commanders during war. No. The responsibilities are many and different in nature. The only way this can happen is for those charged with the responsibility of commissioning officers or enlisting veterans representing the Armed Forces of Nigeria is to strictly abide by the laid down provisions of the law and relevant regulations governing the exercise. We all know. Commissioning of officers, enlisting of soldiers, there are policies, there are regulations, there are guidelines. They are not made for fun. If we want to have the best military, we must comply with all the rules and regulations provided for whatever activity or exercise. You don't follow it then, you don't even get the best. Any breach of the command responsibility stipulated by the laws, regulations governing commissioning or enlistment of personnel. then, if the opposition of Nigeria must be sanctioned accordingly, because it's a fringe of next, postings and appointments of officers, soldiers, relatives, and captain. Postings and appointments of personnel and offices of Nigeria is a major administrative function or responsibility. It is the common responsibility at different levels. For instance, in the Nigerian Army, the Chief of Army Staff, Chief of Administration, Military Secretary, Army, Commander, Army Headquarters, Records, Corps Commanders, etc., as example, play a role in postings and appointments of officers and other ranks, non-commissioned officers, soldiers, veterans, staff, and men. Posting and appointments in the armed forces of Nigeria is a function of law. In other words, there are laid down regulations for posting and appointment of officers. Whoever is in charge of those responsibilities must ensure that he abide by those laid down policies, rules, and regulations if the armed forces is to get the best and move forward. There are laid down rules and regulations, like I said, governing postings and appointments in the armed forces of Nigeria. They must be complied with strictly without any favor or sentiment. A violation of the law in this respect should also be sanctioned. We have the Nigerian Army Administration Policy, revised 2015, made by Department of Army Administration. It contains all the policies on several aspects of administration at the hands of the Army. And they constitute law. So failure to abide by those provisions by persons in charge of the subject becomes an offense. Any officer or other man unfairly treated with regards to posting and appointment should have a right of redress under Section 178 to 179 of the Armed Forces Act. Because the law must be followed. Next, promotion of officers, soldiers, relatives, and their family. This is also an administrative function and responsibility. It is also a function of the law. There are laid down rules and regulations governing promotion in the armed forces of Nigeria, and they must be complied with. It is a responsibility. It is a common responsibility to implement the rules and regulations governing promotion exercise strictly without any sentiment. Any officer or soldier rating or young captain unfairly treated should have a right to redress under Section 178-179 for the Armed Forces Act 2004. Some of the relevant commanders that have the command responsibility for promotions include, of course, the service chief, the military secretaries, chiefs of administration, and so on and so forth. They must ensure that the laid down rules and policies or regulations governing promotion are complied with. It is a responsibility. So, when we talk of command responsibility, we are not only talking of responsibility in the war field. No. Next, payment of salaries and allowances to officers, soldiers, ratings, and aircraft men. This is also a major administrative responsibility. It is similarly a function of the law, which must be respected by those commanders or leaders in charge. Personnel serving and retired must be paid their salaries, pension, of course, pension, gratuity allowances, and whatever they are entitled to by law. Corruption investment with regards to funds made for payment of salaries and allowances of personnel must be dealt with accordingly. The principal commanders, leaders having command responsibility, to ensure the payment of salaries and allowances for personnel of the Armed Forces of Nigeria as at when due, including, of course, the presidency, CPS, service chiefs, chiefs of accounts and budget, formation and units commanders, finance officers at various levels, and so on and so forth. they have responsibility to ensure that whatever is due for personnel is given to them. Because it is a question of law, like I said, all of us know, we have the armed forces financial regulations in which all the allowances that we are entitled to are contained. Whatever you are entitled to is provided in those financial regulations. If it is there, then it is a common responsibility for whoever is installed with that responsibility to ensure that personnel get what is due to them. The payment of reasonable, adequate and timely salaries and allowances to personnel of the armed forces of Nigeria has a great and direct effect on their morale and effective discharge of their duties. That's a linkage. So those who are concerned in that regard should discharge their responsibility as a state of the matter. Next, leave and passes for officers, soldiers, regiments and aircraft men. The grant of annual leave and passes is provided for in the harmonized terms and conditions of service for officers, soldiers, regiments, and aircraft men, as well as other administrative policies in the armed forces. It is covered in the document I just mentioned for the army, that is the administrative policy in 2015. It is therefore a function of law. Leave and passes are welfare issues and impact greatly on the psychological status of the personnel. It has a direct bearing on the efficient and effective discharge of military duties, both in peace and in war. Therefore, if your personnel is entitled by the policies and regulations on the ground to go on annual leave or to be given pass, please, as a leader, as a commander, don't deny me. You have the responsibility to ensure that he gets what he is entitled to by law. Any unfair denial of leave and passes to personnel in the armed forces of Nigeria may result in the increase of absent without leave cases or even desertion. So, in other words, we'll be creating problems. Yes, as a commander, it's at your discretion. Based on what the law says, do not deny your personnel leave or pass based on the subjective reason. The grant of denial of leave and passes is clearly an administrative command responsibility which falls squarely on the shoulders of commanders at all levels, who have troops or personnel under their control. The point is clear. It is a responsibility. So, as a leader, as a commander, we've been told the attributes of a leader. And a leader is a commander. A commander is a leader. It should be fair to everybody. It should be honest. And so on and so forth. It should have this personal leader. Next, discipline, trial of officers, soldiers, ratings, and aircraft men. Discipline is the pillar and bedrock of any armed force globally, including the armed forces of Nigeria. The Armed Forces Act is the principal law governing the affairs of the armed forces of Nigeria. The Armed Forces Act 2004 creates criminal offenses punishable in Part 12, Sections 45 to 114. Officers, soldiers, regiments, and aircraft men are all subject to services as contained in the Armed Forces Act and other applicable laws. As a matter of fact and law, personnel of the Armed Forces of Nigeria are subject to civil laws as well, under the doctrine of compass. Doctrine of compass simply means agreement. Compass is just a legal word, it means agreement. So for you to agree to be in armed forces, then you are subject to what is civil and the military law. Now, any breach of the law by service personnel may result in such a person being investigated, of course, by military police and other investigative conduct. He could be charged and tried summarily or by court martial. Where convicted, appropriate punishment prescribed by law will be awarded. The issue of discipline, trial and punishment of service personnel is a formal responsibility, which is administrative in nature. In this regard, those commanders or leaders at all levels who are bestowed with the powers of investigation, that was clear this year, they have a lot of responsibility in that regard. Powers of convening of court martials, trial, punishment, review of cases, confirmation, as well as ensuring due process and fair hearing in the system, have a sacred duty to discharge these responsibilities as required of them by law. We are all senior officers here, colonels, brigadier generals, most of our commanders, brigadier commanders, and so on. And you have the legal power under the officers act to discipline personnel, court martial personnel, somebody will deal with the personnel that has committed an offense. The military police are there to investigate such offenses. The legal services are there to provide personnel for the court martial to review the cases. Advocacy is there to confirm. So at all these levels, we are expected to discharge our own responsibilities as provided by the law to the best of our ability. And then we have a good system in the office of Nigeria. Those who play critical roles with regards to the issue of discipline, trial and punishment, etc., in the office of Nigeria include, just for example, President CNC, because he can complete a confession. The Section 9 is one of the offices are. The CTS, the service chiefs, chiefs of administration, formation and unit commanders, the ONIA, the PMA, the DLS, all of us have responsibilities with regards to discipline of SM, and we must discharge such responsibilities in accordance with the law and to the best of our ability. Discipline has a direct impact on the operational capability of the armed forces. Justice and fairness for fair hearing have great impact on discipline. And without justice, there will be no discipline. And without discipline, there will be no armed forces. So these are all interwoven. So our military justice system must be taken seriously, and all those who play a role, like I mentioned, it is a responsibility which they must discharge properly. Otherwise, not a problem will come. We all know. The law is clear in the paper, in the book, but do we practice it? Do we go by what the law says? Next. Retirement, discharge of officers, soldiers, rangers, and aircraft men. This is also a command responsibility and administrative in nature. It is also a function of the law. The Armed Forces Act 2004, the head status of officers, soldiers, rangers, and aircraft men, various administrative policies prescribe the conditions upon which a service personnel can be retired from service. These conditions include run-out date, age on rank, medical boarding leave, disciplinary ground, undeployability, failure promotion boss, voluntary application, and so on and so forth. The commanders or leaders at all levels who have the command responsibility to treat the issue of retirement of personnel, must ensure that they comply with the requirements of the law governing the subject matter. Well, I've been wrong as we can, so I'll try and quickly go through the remaining aspect. Well, the important thing is that the subject matter retirement or discharge is also a function of the law, and the law must be followed by those who are in charge. Next, implementation of the harmonized terms and conditions of service. HCAPOS contains so many provisions they are not made for form. So those who are responsible must ensure that those provisions are clearly implemented as provided. Next, training powers of command and legal responsibilities. Here too, I just summarize it. The armed forces have a lot of training institutions. For instance, in Nigerian Army, there is no corps that does not have a training scheme. The latest among which is Magon Corps, that's the Legal Services. We now have the Nigerian Army School of Legal Service, the Zaria. So all these training institutions and the Department of Training and Operations that are engaged with the issue of training, they have responsibility to ensure the best for the armed forces. There should be no sentiment in selecting who should go for court, whether in Nigeria or abroad. The laws must be followed. There should be issues of examination malpractice should be dealt with, and so on and so forth. These are all responsibilities. These are all responsibilities. I'm just summarizing because of time. So the point here is that when you talk of command responsibility, please, I'm repeating it again, as far as the law is concerned, it is wide. It's not just about operation. Next, operational powers of command and legal responsibilities. That is exactly what the GOC 1D lecture about. That is the, okay, let me just quickly, I will not waste time. The military profession is all about the conduct of operations. This is basically fighting wars and providing aid to civil authorities by restoring law and order during internal crisis. Military operations entail very, very serious command responsibilities. Even wars have laws. Breach of these laws of war carry sanctions which may include death penalty. Now, like I said, the lecture by the GOC is on operations. So, it's just a part of command responsibility. I just want to read the communal section 239 in view of what the GOC told us regarding the incident of the that happened between the army and Shia in Kaduna. The law section 239 is very, very clear. I read, no, that is indemnity for actions in aid to civil authority and military duty. It says, no action, prosecution, or other proceeding shall lie against a person subject to service law under this act for an act done in pursuance of execution or intended execution of this act, for any regulation, service duty, authority, or in respect of an alleged neglect or default in execution of this act, regulation, duty, or authority, if it is done in aid to civil authority or in execution of military duty. Once you have given a duty officially, you are indemnified. You cannot be prosecuted. Section 239 is clear. Except you go outside the rules of regulations, the rules of engagement. Once you perform your duty officially within the rules of engagement, you are indemnified. You cannot be prosecuted. Section 239 is very, very clear. So, next is rank-based powers of command and legal responsibilities. This one, too, I'll just summarize it in one sentence. What this one means simply is that in the armed forces of Nigeria, which is a hierarchical organization, the superior has authority over the subordinates. For instance, a subordinate can be charged, and even jailed under the armed forces and for insubordination. If you are a subordinate to your superior, you can be dealt with. Also, the superior too has responsibility to the inferior. In treatment of an officer or a person of inferior rank is also a criminal offense under Section 92 of the Armed Forces Act. So, if you unfairly treat a person you are subordinate, you can be jailed. Even if very clear, our laws are good. The issue is, do we respect these laws? Do we implement them? So, first side, superior, subordinate have responsibilities under the law, and they have combined responsibilities. They have more responsibilities. Conclusion. This paper has clearly established the fact that command is leadership. Leadership involves the exercise of authority. Authority is given by law. Law creates responsibilities. Leadership carries responsibilities. In the office of Nigeria, command responsibility is from top to bottom, from the presidency in C down to platoon commander. command can equally be exercised by the superior over a subordinate, like I said, and vice versa, both have responsibilities. Command responsibilities in our forces are of different nature and category. These are in terms of administration, training, operation, and even rank. That's superior subordinate. The commander who issues an illegal order, for instance, instruction or directive, breaches law and commits offense. Conversely, a subordinate who obeys a manifestly illegal order equally commits offense. The role and services of legal officers to a commander in discharge of his numerous responsibilities at all levels in the armed forces of Nigeria is indispensable. That should be right. Recommendations. It is recommended as follows. Commanders at all levels in the armed forces of Nigeria should continuously improve and update their knowledge of military law in particular, and of course municipal and international laws in general. Commanders at all levels in the armed forces of Nigeria should respect and uphold due process and rule of law at all times. C. Commanders at all levels in the armed forces of Nigeria should seek legal advice before taking decisions on major and important issues. Before, not after. Lastly, the Nigerian Army School of Legal Studies should introduce a new course on legal aspects of command responsibilities for commanders, potential commanders in the Nigerian Army, in particular, and the Army of Nigerian Border Security Agencies in general. Thank you very much.